Greetings from the Asian Productivity Organization Secretariat, Tokyo, and welcome to all viewers to another very interesting productivity talk on the topic Productivity, Recovery and Regrowth. I am Mohammad Zafarullah from the APO Secretariat, and I will be the moderator for today's P-Talk. The world has seen myriad challenges since onset of the COVID-19 pandemic, one of the worst crises we have faced in the past 80 years. It has resulted in declines in per capita income and increased poverty levels, adversely affected investments and global trade, lowered labor productivity, and disrupted supply chains. This has led us to think about our future more consciously, from individual to national level. We have all been affected by this pandemic in one way or another. It has forced the world to adopt new approaches to overcome the challenges from lifestyle to work styles. Today's P-Talk centers on the importance of productivity in recovering from the economic crisis in developing countries after the deep disruptions caused by the COVID-19 pandemic. It will also discuss ways and means to address ongoing challenges, overcome barriers to productivity, and approaches and options available for stimulating growth and economic development. We are fortunate to have Dr. Ali Sajid, Director, Lahore School of Management, Pakistan, with us today to share his thought on productivity as a means for recovery and regrowth. Good morning, Dr. Sajid, and thank you so much for giving us your valuable time. How are you today, sir?
Fine, thank you. And from my side, greeting to the viewers across the globe.
Before proceeding to the presentation, let me briefly introduce Dr. Ali Sajid. Dr. Sajid received the Tamgha-e-Imtiaz or National Medal of Distinction in 2005 from the President of Pakistan in recognition of his contributions to productivity improvement. In addition to serving as an advisor to the government of Pakistan on productivity and quality, over the 25 years he has been involved in teaching, educational administration, and training and development in both the public sector and corporate environment. At present, he is also Chairman, Quality and Productivity Society of Pakistan. As a researcher, Dr. Sajid has published more than 10 papers in academic journals and given more than 25 presentations at international conferences in Asia, the Middle East, Europe, and the USA. He also conceived and launched 4 management and business schools in Pakistan, and has been involved in designing and launching new programs in both Pakistan and the USA. Dr. Sajid received a BSc in Engineering from the University of Engineering and Technology, Lahore, and MS and PhD in Engineering Management from George Washington University, USA, where he also taught for many years and worked at the World Bank headquarters. Now I will turn over the session to Dr. Sajid to deliver his presentation and share his thoughts. Dr. Sajid, the session is yours.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor, it's my privilege to share my thoughts on this very important topic. Let me congratulate the APO to arrange such kind of intellectual activities with a view to upgrade the knowledge, skills, and perceptions of people, especially in the developing nations like Pakistan. Today's discussion is meant to assess the impact of COVID-19 on the productivity, number one, and to see and reassess the strategies for recovery and regrowth. It will be around 40 minutes plus minus presentation, followed by a Q&A session in which I would be happy to respond to any questions you may have. This presentation is typically designed into 5 parts. First is introduction. Second is impact of COVID-19 on productivity. This is the major crux of the discussion, and I will share my own thoughts, experience being a resident of developing country. And the third is driver of productivity, the element which has been or will be instrumental in pushing the productivity up, boosting the productivity. And the fourth is suggestions for recovery and regrowth. And fifth one, the last one, is conclusion. Now, with this background, as all we know, that this COVID-19 has plunged the global economy into the deepest possible recession that history has seen in the last 100 years plus, especially after Second World War. And per capita income of 90% of the country reduced or going to be declined in the coming months or years. 10 of millions of the labor force will be tipped off into poverty. So COVID-19 would have adverse impact on many things. First of all, it will substantially reduce the investment, especially in the developing nations. Secondly, the likelihood of a ruin of human capital because of unemployment, the biggest or greatest threat in the aftermath of COVID-19, loss of schooling. And this factor is more pronounced in the LDCs, that is least developing countries, where internet is not common, smartphone is not common, and school kids cannot do homeschooling while sitting in the home in the COVID era. So loss of schooling day was and has been another adverse impact. And the fourth one is possible retreat from the global trade and supply linkages because of level of sensitivity and social distancing. In most cases, inland and overseas transport in certain cases stand still or halted, and that impacted productivity in the lower side and limit ability of economies for the growth. This was the background in which we are starting our discussion today. Now, as discussed by our host, that COVID-19 damaged labor productivity, and that was affected both from supply end and demand side. It also had, first of all, adverse impact on supply side, and there are three reasons. First is depletion of labor force. Absence of labor force from the shop floor, manufacturing, supply of goods and services was depleted because of restrictions, COVID restrictions, and it also tightened the financial conditions of the bank. Thirdly, it also disrupted the supply chain across the globe, both internally and internationally. These are the adverse supply side effect of COVID. Now let us quickly review how the demand side was affected. As you might have observed, that demand side was also affected badly because of the fact that consumer demand was depressed. And there are three reasons for this. First reason was good and services supply was affected and less required. Secondly, business confidence and investment was badly eroded, and people shattered their trust on the existing chain of supply or supply line. And third is rising financial cost. Financing cost means cost of borrowing money has increased to substantial level, especially in the least developing countries. Now, in the second part, I would like to assess the impact of COVID on productivity. As you might have noticed, that COVID-19 restricted mobility of people, and that restriction slows down the geographical and sectorial labor reallocation. And immediate response to COVID-19, again, the question mark, the first thing is, to me, it is revenue shortfall, which compelled the industry to be more efficient, more effective, and required to give results with the least amount of input resources. Second, business now started to rethinking their existing range of products, business style, and operating models, and ways to increase their operational efficiency. And they wanted to be more responsive to these contextual changes. I will continue and place more focus on impact of COVID on productivity. Now, as you might have been observing since last many decades, that 70% of natural disasters are climate related, and decline in productivity is mainly due to natural disasters, number one, wars, major economic disruptions, financial crises, and deep recessions. We will discuss in detail in the coming part. So number of natural disasters in year 2000 to 2018 doubled from the preceding two decades. This is very alarming figure. Health crisis occurred less frequently than the climate disaster, and that is relatively a plus point. As you might be observing that in the last 20 years or so, four major epidemic emerged on the face of globe. First was swine flu from 2009 to 10. Second is SARS. Third is MERS, that is Mid-East Respiratory Syndromes, that happened in 2012. And fourth is Ebola, that is a recent phenomena, 6 or 7 years ago, 2014 to 2015, and Zika. These four or five epidemics occurred in the last 20 years, but these epidemics were having less intensity, less gravity as compared to COVID-19. However, these epidemics left scarring, lasting scars on labor productivity and output by 4% reduction cumulatively. And these may had adverse impact on investment due to elevated uncertainty. That prevailing uncertainty is causing people not to invest, stay in the home, and wait for the good time. That prevailing uncertainty is killing the labor force issues and problems, and also giving rise to one fact, that is lack of trust and confidence in the existing market, thereby stopping people not to invest, and investment is shattered badly. Now, the third impact on productivity is heightened vulnerability in the existing system and record high debt also give rise to many problems. And that was aggravated and compounded and made more complex when COVID-19 hit global economy. Now, in this background, it is possible to understand, it is very much reasonable to deduce that productivity losses are aggravated from pandemic. So COVID-19 is causing negative impact on productivity because of these three or four things you can see on the view file. Firstly, weaker investment and trade. Secondly, a ruin of human capital and shift in labor market. Fourth, slowing momentum in labor reallocation. And next is heavy debt burdens, especially to least developing nations, mostly from South Asia and Latin America. Now, I will try to share some very important findings of the studies, that is impact of COVID-19 on productivity. So we see estimated impact of COVID-19 on productivity varies, and it mainly depends which measures of productivity you are going to use. On the right hand side of this slide, you see the percentage impact of COVID-19 from 0 to 10 and 0 to minus 30 or 40 on y-axis. On x-axis, you see the number of years, and 2020 quarter one, end of quarter one, is the beginning of this COVID-19 disaster across the globe, and it gradually intensified. So let us quickly review the impact of this COVID on labor productivity per job, number one, and labor productivity per hour, number two. Labor productivity per hour is being depicted in yellow color, and labor productivity per job is being depicted in the form of gray lines. And you see there's a steep decline and sharp fall in the beginning of second quarter, and it went down. I mean, labor productivity per job went down in the tune of 30% negative. That is the first thing. And the second thing is, labor productivity per hour reduced, but not the same level as that of labor productivity per job. And that reduced close to zero, but did not fall into the negative category and now likely to rise again. And total factor productivity is being depicted in the form of blue lines, total factor productivity. And total factor productivity by definition is total productivity divided by the productivity of capital and labor that has less impact on its performance. So major impact of COVID-19 was on labor productivity per job, as you can see from the view file. Next, fourth part, which we are going to analyze, is impact of COVID-19 on productivity. And you see business faced large reduction in various sectors in terms of productivity within firms due to social measures. And social measures are social distancing, for example, use of excessive vaccines or chemicals to desanitize your hand and body parts. So one study assessed impact of COVID-19 on hourly labor productivity and TFP, that is total productivity, total factor productivity, and both measures of productivity negatively affected by COVID-19. This was a study, recent study done by Mr. Bloom on 2020. So in the first part, on the right-hand side of the view file, you see the first part, we see the impact of COVID on the total factor productivity, and the blue shade shows TFP between the firms. Yellow color shows TFP, that is total factor productivity, within firms, and black line shows total. And you can see in the beginning of epidemic, that is second quarter of 2020, the impact on TFP within the firm was substantially negative compared to blue line, that is TFP between the firms. So you see the TFP between the firms remain less effective or less negative affected compared to the TFP within the firms. On the right hand side, the second figure, hourly labor productivity. Let us quickly review the impact of hourly labor productivity on the performance. Now you see again the yellow color shows the hourly labor productivity within firms, number one, and blue color shows hourly labor productivity between the firms. Now this impact was highest in fourth quarter of 2020, that is December last year, and gradually it is diminishing and reducing, and we foresee some positive development in the coming days because of overall improvement in the situation. So study assessed the impact of COVID-19 on two things in this case. Number one, hourly labor productivity, and number two, total factor productivity. And you see both measures of productivity are negatively affected by this COVID. The fifth part is also a very interesting study, the result of a very interesting study. You can see on the view file, and that is percentage impact of COVID-19. On the x-axis, you see the quarter starting from 2019 fourth quarter when it emerged in China, and 2020 second quarter when it went to the peak across the globe. And now you see the unit cost increased first in the first quarter of 2020, and gradually it is expected to taper off around 4% by the 2021 quarter two, and see smaller impact on cost of under 2% in the coming next year, that is 2020. Likewise, after unit cost, you see the impact on prices, that is negative in the first initial part because of lesser demand, and impact on employment was also negative 6 to 5%, and gradually it improved. And again, sales had the largest negative impact in the second quarter and third quarter. Gradually it improved, and sales plunged down and fallen in the tune of 35 to 40%. This was the reason that big companies facing the starvation of capital flow. Now, sixth part of review of impact of COVID-19 on productivity. So firms, there are certain firms which are having the low productivity, for example, accommodation, food, and recreation services. And they have the largest drop in our work. Why they have the largest drop in our work? Because they cannot provide their services while sitting in the home, and they cannot deliver online certain kind of activities or kind of services. So face-to-face contact is essential, and social activity is very much integral part of this accommodation, food, and recreational service sector, which is low in productivity. So let us quickly review the percentage impact of COVID-19. It is from zero to left-hand side, minus 100, and on the right-hand side, 150. And you see from the template, total hours in 2020, quarter two, is depicted in the blue lines. Red line shows total hours in 2021, quarter two, that is after 1 year, the positive or negative impact. So this is basically a comparative study of total hours spent or dropped out. And third is your gray color, that is pre-COVID labor productivity. And you see that that light gray color in the real estate, they that is the maximum, having the maximum labor productivity. And but when first quarter of 2020 started, you see the negative impact and number of hours lost. And that was maximum in three low productivity sector, as mentioned earlier. That is recreational services, number one, accommodation and food, number two, and then related service in the recreational side. Now, what is the global reset? What is the global reset after the COVID shock to global economy? Supply chain revealed their fragility, that they are not very robust to sustain the extraordinary pressure, or not able to give the response as per emergency. The first impact was on supply chain. And supply chain bottlenecks hit a variety of industries from retailing to manufacturing. And thirdly, overstretched health sector, especially in the developing countries like South Asia, like Latin American countries, like Afghanistan, African countries. And that was the biggest challenge for governments, and that affected lives and livelihood both adversely. And there was the cases arises when people start looting because of food. So this was the biggest challenge. The capacity of public sector health system was overburdened because of COVID. On the right hand side, you see the impact on international trade as percentage of GDP in 2010 to 2022. And on the y-axis, you see percentage of GDP. And on the x-axis, you see number of years. Blue line shows developed countries, and yellow line shows emerging and developing countries. Now, you see the drop is projected to be more sharper compared to developed countries in developing countries. So developing countries are more adversely affected compared to the developed countries. This is a very good finding of study. And that is impact on global economy and global positioning of various countries. Now, second part of global positioning or reset is impact on e-commerce. Now, I'm going to share very good news. The e-commerce grown faster than before. And there was a study conducted in which one company of USA, they acknowledged this fact that their e-commerce grew in 3 weeks faster than last 2 years. Now, this e-commerce faster development was given a comparative analysis in three countries, that is China, India, and Japan. You see e-commerce, that is sharp blue color shows 2016 to 19 average, that is 3% growth. in e-commerce in China, the first case, and you see it increased and enhanced by 2020, 1.6% times, and it grew from 3% to 4.8 times, three times to 4.8 times. So that was difference or development or progress made in e-commerce in the era of post-COVID-19. The second country which was selected for this study was India. And you see, it grew from 0.7 to 1.6 times. That is cumulative growth of 2.1 times increase. And Japan from 0.6 to 1.1, and that is growth of 1.8 times. That is a brief description of global reset. Now, there was also occupation shift, which is projected by 2030 in the post-COVID-19 scenario. Most obvious impact of COVID-19 on labor was drastic increase in remote working. Remote work and virtual meetings will continue in the coming days, in coming months, with, of course, less intensity than the pandemic peak. And trend accelerated by COVID-19 may spur greater change in creating mix of jobs within economies than estimated before. Again, a quick comparison of Japan, China, and India is given on the right-hand side, which shows estimated change in share of total employment post-COVID-19 scenario, and that is projected up to 2030 year. Next analysis is transition to new jobs in post-COVID-19 scenario. Now, 25% more workers need to switch occupations than before COVID-19. This is because of a couple of factors. The first is greater automation and digitization, and second is enhanced level of operational efficiency. Now, this study shows a quick comparison of four countries, United States, Japan, China, and India. On the bottom side, you see job transition in post-COVID-19 scenario in million. United States was having 17.1 million more jobs in terms of transition, not more jobs, but transition of the jobs. And second is Japan, 3.9 million, China, 54.4 million, and India, 17.9 million. Now you see India has three times more population than USA, but job transition in India and United States is almost same. That shows the impact of automation and digitization on job transition. Now, another very important and last finding of the study so far, I'm going to announce and brief you. That is COVID-19 response of business and government was bold and positive, in certain cases proactive. And broad action still is needed for productivity enhancement. And for that matter, we need to boost consumption, number one, and number two, enhance investment. And much depend on decisions of policymakers, especially in the developing countries and the business owners in the LDCs. If actions to ensure productivity remains concentrated and demand not robust, then what will happen? We will see sluggish recovery like we have seen after global financial crisis of 2007 to 2019. That recovery was very sluggish because of this fact that demand was not robust and productivity remained stagnant and concentrated. Now, the opposite to that, a period of fast economic renewal similar to post-World War II could emerge if we take action to broaden demand and take certain actions to enhance the demand and strengthening the demand. So those broadened action will add real value and will facilitate greatly for fast economic renewal. And right hand side of this presentation, this view file, you will see four scenarios. In first scenario, you will see on the x-axis demand growth, upper side of the demand growth, you will get the explanation of unleashed broad-based high consumption and instrumental investment growth, High consumption, investment growth, unleashed and broad-based. That is upper side of demand growth. On the lower side of demand growth, x-axis you see constrained. And what are the constraints? First of all, broad income losses and deleveraging. Now, upper or lower side, you see the two famous scenario. First is stagnation, which happened in USA in the post oil shock that started from 1973 and lasted till next 10 years in 83, in which you see the stagflation. And the second scenario, lost decade or depression. This happened in Japan when the property bubble burst, and total impact was 0.7, which was less. Now, on the x-axis of this diagram, you see potential supply growth. And on the right-hand side, we have acceleration of innovation and dynamism, which of course add more speed, more value, more strength to the scenario. And you see in the lower part of quadrant, low growth and or great divide. US post global financial scenario, in which you see the very sluggish growth that started from 2007 and lasted till 2019. And the best example of productivity growth was an era after the Second World War, which started from 1939 and lasted 1973. Here you see more potential supply growth and more potential demand growth. This gives a total rise of 3.1 and make the block bigger. Now, companies shifted. What is the best evidence for the companies after the COVID eruption? First is their response was bold and innovative in response to pandemic. Companies shifted rapidly to online channels, automated production tasks, increased operational efficiency, speedy decision making was become the norm at that time, and innovation of operational model was again very common. So that could potentially double rate of annual productivity growth observed after financial crisis, global financial crisis. Now, post-COVID-19 productivity growth, you see an economic activities, all economic activities plunged, firms taking bold steps for business transformation, and those bold steps are very important to note. First of all, they enhanced the pace of digitization, number one, and technologies were quickened. Business become more efficient and agile, and remote working become norms. Many business people went online first time in their life, and they also have broken their reluctance and hesitation not to use the online facilities. And there are also some advances in drivers which boosted productivity in the past. Now the same drivers are being used economy-wise pace of productivity growth in larger leading firms. This is the prototype which we use to implement and extend and incorporate on the bigger firm or larger firm. Now, post-COVID-19 productivity growth, how? Now, there is a potential to accelerate annual productivity growth by about 1% potential till 2024. This is the finding of a recent study carried out by McKinsey Global Institute. And they have taken the sample of 7 countries. One is USA and remaining Western countries, Western European countries, starting from Germany, France, UK, Sweden, and Spain. And they forecasted that they are expected to double the productivity growth compared to pre-pandemic rate of productivity growth. This is a welcome news, and I must appreciate that extra collective effort. Realizing this potential requires certain actions. And first action, the foremost actions to be more widespread, number one. And demand should be more robust, number two. And 60% of productivity potential could come, first of all, because of increasing operational efficiency, and that could be done only by two things. Number one, digitization, and number two, automation. If we do not take these two things on war footing, on emergency footing, we are facing the risk of rising inequality and employment. That is the real global threat, and we must focus on digitization and automation. Now, if we, and this is the undermining demand, and if we put off this demand, and if we do not place more emphasis on this demand, what will happen? We will not be able to reap the benefit of productivity, enhanced productivity. So robust demand is keyword I am using time and again. Next way for productivity growth. More than 50% of estimated productivity potential is likely to come from two things. Number one, you cut labor and another input cost. And number two, by increasing automation. And McKinsey Global Economic Condition Survey showed significant result in business moving to efficient and agile ways of operation. And they believed COVID-19 and changes to economic fabric would accelerate their creation of new jobs and new services. A quick comparison on the right-hand side clearly shows and indicate potentially productivity enhancing drivers. What are the elements which have been instrumental to boost the productivity? The first part is operational automation and technology is the first driving force. It used to be 55, now it is likely to be 75. That is pre-COVID and pre-COVID-19 pandemic starting from 2014 to 2019. And second is, that is the black color is depicting that part. And the blue color is depicting post-COVID-19. And you see the difference in the first scenario, that is automation and technology, there is likelihood of 20% more increase in automation and technology as a booster for productivity. Second is operational efficiency. In the pre-COVID era, it used to be 30, now it is likely to be 35%. Likewise, reorganization and agility. In the pre-COVID part, it used to be 55% and now it is 70% projected. That is the impact we are registering positively in the productivity growth side. And these are the booster. Now, the last, maybe second last question is productivity boost how? So bold innovation under pandemic pressure can boost productivity. But we need two actions if we want to increase productivity. First of all, we need to enhance the level and scope of corporate action, and we need to broaden them. And number two, generate the robust demand. Without that, any bold innovation may not work. So benefit of productivity boost will not likely to be distributed evenly. And investment in intangible is sensitive to credit conditions. For example, what is intangibles? Intangibles are digital technologies, and that could not be made without capital or investment. So intangible investment may define or decline rather if financial conditions tighten, number one, and firm's balance sheet become worsen and worsen on showing the negative borrowed money. So now we conclude this part, that 10% rise in intangible capital investment, that is digital technology, is associated with about a rise of 4.5% in labor productivity. So there's a dire need to invest more on intangible capital investment, that is digital technology. And American firms who become the superstars and Western European firms who become the superstars are using this as a instrument to get the leverage in the international scenario. Productivity boost how? There are three or four examples I'm going to give you. First of all, digitalization of bank services, for example, routine services in the service sector, automation, replacement of human manpower to automate the process, then e-commerce, and then remote working. And these trends are unlikely to reverse. And recent investment in digital tools also give more boost to productivity. And you see in everyday life during the peak time of pandemic, video conference was very common. File sharing application also become very common. Drone and data mining technologies are also becoming common and very much popular among the semi-literate people across the globe, thereby enhancing the productivity. Role of export as a major source of productivity was another form, like success of East Asian through export-led strategy failed to replicate Africa, Latin America, Caribbean, West Asia, and South Asia. So major impetus to productivity growth comes from the export. Next is labor productivity in developing regions. Again, these Eastern Asian countries, Far Eastern Asian countries, they become the leader in export through two steps. First, they converted low value added to high value added and low technology product to high value added technologies or high tech products. And they were able to gain the global major share of global value chain, which enabled them to build productive capacity, number one, and diversify their export metrics. And they use export for productivity growth. And they were able to significantly reallocation of resources and accumulation of technological capacities. So potential productivity enhancing drivers are, number one, creating new product or services. Number two, accelerating implementation of upskilling, reskilling due to COVID-19. And thirdly, targeting new customer and using new channels. New customer base identification using the technologies is the third productivity enhancement enabler or driver or booster. And the fourth is adopting new revenue models, how, when, where, and by whom. So these four productivity enhancement drivers accelerated the recovery of post-COVID-19 recovery. Now, let me quickly see second last part, suggestions for recovery and regrowth. So we can lift productivity and we need to address some core issues. As pandemic recedes, important to implement reforms to enhance potential productivity gains. And these things are afterthoughts in least developing countries, South Asian countries, and Latin American countries. Most reviews source and reasons of slowdown of productivity growth. We must see what are the impediments, roadblock, or bottlenecks for productivity growth, and how to make a multi-pronged policy needed to lift productivity, the core job of policymakers of developing nations and emerging economies. Without that, they may not be able to sustain the negative impact of COVID-19. Building back better after pandemic. How to gain from pandemic? Now, first gain is better education and dynamic labor reallocation. And second is where learning outcome were poor. Government investment in widespread internet access is essential and mandatory, with a view to broaden access to quality online schoolings and training. That is the second gain after the pandemic. Third is better targeted social security net could prevent school dropouts. And fourth is better educated labor force would be more productive and less likely to be replaced by automation. That are the four lessons we learned from the pandemic. Developing countries must reassess export-led development strategy for enhanced productivity. And scale of COVID-19 and gravity and intensity of COVID-19 with recent technological advances is a major force of change. We must take this message and lesson. And suggestion for recovery and growth to reap benefit of productivity from investment to intangibles, ensure adequate access to financing for viable companies. And two more suggestions. First of all, government must ensure efficient reallocation of resources, and they must take solid steps to protect the vulnerable and weak and marginalized group. This can support a strong recovery. Recovery can be achieved in multiple ways. Ensure capital in failed firms and put them into efficient use elsewhere, and increase productivity to create economic growth. So what we conclude? Conclusion is, COVID-19 pandemic caused a deepest economic disruption in developing countries. Recovery of economic growth possible through focus on productivity enhancement, number one, and through which we can earn higher revenue and ultimately generate higher GDP. And lastly, the pandemic highlighted need for more resilient and flexible supply chain, which showed their fragility in the early part of pandemic. Now, I would like to extend my gratitude, my special thanks to APO for arranging this kind of intellectual discussion to stimulate intellectual curiosity. Thank you from my side. I'm open for the questions now.
Thank you for that very insightful presentation, highlighting the approaches and options available for stimulating growth and economic development in the public and private sector in developing countries. The economic impact of COVID-19 has been significant, especially on emerging and developing economies. It is important to concentrate on improving productivity and competitiveness to overcome losses due to the pandemic, accept new challenges, and change to meet future demand. Dr. Sajid, we have a few questions on behalf of our viewers as well. Let's get started with the questions. Our first question is regarding the gross domestic product growth. Recently, real GDP growth has slowed significantly in many countries. Which factors should be addressed to maintain balanced GDP growth? What is your opinion in this regard?
The dilemma with the developing nations, especially with the South Asian and Latin American and African countries and Caribbean countries, they are not investing a substantial amount of money on human resource development. I believe there's a positive correlation between GDP growth and capacity building or human resource development. This is maybe last or second last thing in their national priorities. They need to prioritize first. That is a fun thing. Then technology upgradation and use of automation and digitization is the second way they can increase productivity that leads to enhanced level of GDP growth. That is the second factor, I believe. And third is quality and productivity enhancement initiative. Productivity enhancement requires reduced rework, reduced white and blue collar waste, and reduced time lost or material lost in the process of production or services. Now, there's a dire need that developing nations should pay more attention on productivity enhancement initiative. They should train their staff and high-tech professionals from good agencies like ILO, International Labour Organization, like APO, to understand the better demand of the industry and services and businesses. That factor is lacking, due to which I don't foresee any positive development or growth in the GDP of developing countries. Effective R&D policy is also a very important factor. In developing nations, the R&D is mainly on the non-applied issues. There's a need for applied R&D on the agriculture sector and non-farm sector as well. And they should focus more on BMR, that is balancing modernization and rehabilitation in their industry, and invest more on automation and digitization. And they use artificial intelligence and data sciences to speed up their industry. Without that, I'm afraid they may not be able to add any value or gain substantial progress in terms of GDP growth. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts on importance of investment, technology, and productivity. While talking about COVID-19 adverse impact, you mentioned about erosion of human capital because of unemployment. Our next question is to know more about this factor. Declines in employment and increases in unemployment have affected GDP, especially in emerging and developing economies. What are their policy options to address these problems and avoid labor market stagnation?
Unemployment or underemployment is major challenges for developing nations in all four regions I mentioned earlier. Yet these governments can take various initiatives. First of all, to me, is massive industrialization. For that matter, they need to establish special economic zones and trade promotion zones and these kind of stuff. they should make their internal political situation more attractive and more conducive to attract the foreign direct investment. That is the missing part. The rise of China in the last 35 years in the post Deng Xiaoping era after 1979 or 80 is mainly attributed to one fact, that is excessive foreign direct investment in the average of in the tune of 50 to 100 millions, billions of dollars, $100 billion average in those years. And of course, the technology transfer was the second part, which came along with the foreign direct investment. So what I suggest, that third thing which governments of developing countries should to address the rising challenge of un- and underemployment is to reskill and upskill the capacity of their youth. That is again a missing part and missing element. And they should follow the strategy of learn, unlearn, and relearn. They should not focus on old technologies and give ample opportunity to their youth to relearn the new technologies. That is missing part again in the developing nations. And I believe on-the-job training is the best answer for that. I carried out one study and made a program for Pakistan Engineering Council last year, in which I was able to create a very strong document, which is likely to be implemented very soon for the jobless technical graduates and engineers, whereby they were given stipend and 6-month mandatory training to upgrade their skills. We called it on the job training, OJT. These kind of initiatives are likely to give jobs to 10 to 20,000 technical graduates, high-tech graduates, by changing or enhancing or diversifying their level skills set. And that initiative should be used at a broader level, at a macro level. Tax concession is another way to encourage massive industrializations, and import substitution is one way which was used by the Pacific Rim countries. Self-employment and starting new business, startup, technology incubation centers are another way to encourage people to do their own job. Don't give them fish, tell them how to fish. That is the message of 21st century. We need to understand this important message. And last is role of international agencies like ILO, APO, UNIDO, UNDP to improve the skill set of youth in these countries. These steps, I believe, will largely address the growing problem of unemployment. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing your opinion. I agree with that we need to focus more on learning, unlearning, and relearning, and skilling and reskilling of our youth as well. Let's move to our next question. Some firms are affected more and had largest drop in overworked, which adversely affected their productivity level. In this regard, we would like to ask you, firms in low productivity sectors are affected more during times of crisis. How can they reduce the current negative impacts?
That is a good question. I have myself observed that in countries like developing countries like Pakistan, low productivity sectors are badly impacted by COVID-19. To me, the solution is in two parts. The first is automation, and second is digitization. And thirdly, use of artificial intelligence, and the fourth is business intelligence. These will increase their operational efficiency. Increase in efficiency will add up to 60% in productivity improvement. This strategy is effectively working across the globe and in most part of Asia, starting from Japan, Malaysia, Vietnam, Thailand, and newly industrialized countries like Taiwan and Korea. So I believe this is the only recipe available for them to address the threats of negative productivity or negative impact of the COVID. In addition, I believe they should restructure and invest more on their job description, reorganize them, simplify the processes and their SOPs, and also use business process reengineering to cut the red tape. The developing nation red tape or slow speed of doing business is major impediment to the productivity. So business process reengineering is one thing, and and reinventing the process and simplifying the process is the second thing. In addition, they should go for international certification of doing business in their respective area of influence. And significant reallocation of resources, the second last thing I would suggest to add. And the last thing is accumulation of technological capacities. They need to enhance their technical skills and capacity to deliver and technological capabilities. And they also extend more resources to expand their base for export to earn the foreign exchange.
Thank you, Dr. Sajid. It was very interesting to know from you how firms in low productivity sectors can reduce the negative impacts. Speed of doing business to match the current needs is obviously very important. Dr. Sajid, you also talked about productivity in your presentation. Which options are currently available for governments to boost productivity and achieve private sector-led growth?
You see, the main engine of growth in developing nations should be and would be and ideally must be integral part of their strategy of policy formulation is using more reliance on private sector. Now, empowering the private sector is key to success. How to empower private sectors? First of all, their capacity building by the state agencies. In Pakistan, we have started a Kamyab Naujawan program. In English, it is called Successful Youth Initiative, in which government of Pakistan is investing billions of dollars to economically empower youth by enhancing their technical skills. Kamyab Naujawan program is one way to replicate in the international level in the developing nations, number one. Public-private partnership, number two. Built, and the third policy measure or instrument could be BOOT, that is built, own, operate, and transfer. Private sector should be called to build the project, own, operate, and transfer after 25, 30 years. This is very much common even in the developed countries like Canada. I have myself seen and bought, built, own, and transfer. This is the fourth element. Private sector must be given the free hand to deliver and must be incorporated to the public sector for support. And privatization of state-owned enterprises. State-owned enterprises are white elephant, which are wasting resources in the tune of trillions of rupees or billions of dollars in developing nations, especially in India and Pakistan. So they must be privatized forthwith, and they must be given to the private sector with a view to add element of efficiency, effectiveness, efficacy, and efficiency, all of them. And I also suggest that they must focus their own mind towards digitization and also on the automation and remote working and also using various kind of technology like drone technology, data mining, and file sharing, etc. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts and some latest required initiatives. Dr. Sajid, due to some time constraints, we can have one more question as it is very important and related to the productivity drivers. You also talked about the global reset and pandemic accelerated the shift towards automation and digitalization. Most drivers of productivity have been negatively impacted by the pandemic. Which drivers should now receive more focus to offset this? What is your opinion in this regard?
I believe the productivity booster or productivity enhancement drivers are about 4 to 5 categories. First of all, we need to see how we create new products and create their demand in the market. 100 years ago, nobody drinks tea in South Asia, but Britishers who were master of this, who were ruling elite of South Asia at that time, they created that need among the masses. So we need to find the new product and new kind of services based upon technology, number one. And we need to upgrade the skill level of the team or workforce, number two. And thirdly, I firmly believe they should target new customer base. They should try to find the new cluster of customers and new channel of selling their businesses. I am using Facebook. I'm no longer using print media for promotion of my business. So these are the new kind of channels we are using. And the force is adopting new revenue models. That is the financial part, and that is a missing part again in the developing nation. We must focus on these four to get the desired results. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sajid. That was very insightful from you. And we just discussed about the technology, innovation, investment, digitalization, and automation. All those things are very important for productivity improvement as well. So in this context, I would like to take one more question from you. It would be fine if you can answer to this question. This is very interesting in the present scenario. A technology adoption has occurred faster than ever during the pandemic. Do you see this as a blessing, or is it another challenge for emerging and developing economies?
I think this is a blessing in disguise. Nature has given the developing nations to get them exposure of blessing and reaping the blessing of technology and abandon the obsolete system of doing the business. Business as usual will not work at all. So induction of technology is the core area which we need to focus. So in this regard, I would focus on four areas of technology. First of all, technology management. Second is technology forecast, technology planning, and technology upgradation, and technology acquisition, and technology transfer. These five or six elements, when combined, will give a very comprehensive package to the private sector or public sector industry in developing nations. And these five factors are, again, not very common and neither given the due attention which they well deserve. I strongly encourage the policymaker to focus on these five things in the reference of technology, in the context of technology. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sajid. Thank you so much for giving us your insights over the past hour. Our viewers in APO member countries and beyond have gained a lot from this session. Before this P-Talk is over, do you have any final thoughts for our viewers?
I believe developing nations should not curtail the demand for production. They should boost the demand for production, number one. Number two, they should invest more on technology in the five factors I just mentioned. These are the two points, key points I would like to focus.
Thank you very much. We really appreciate having you here today, Dr. Ali Sajid. Thank you for your joining us, and I am sure that our viewers enjoyed this thought-provoking P-Talk. COVID-19 has affected our lives in different ways, and its impact is visible in all walks of life. Lessons from the pandemic have strengthened our belief that productivity and competitiveness are important drivers of economic recovery and regrowth, especially for emerging and developing countries. Hence, we can say productivity, our pathway to recovery and regrowth. Viewers, if you are hungry for the latest knowledge on productivity, please join us in other P-Talks, which are broadcasted every Tuesday and Thursday. Subscribing to our APO YouTube channel will ensure that you remain updated. Goodbye for now. Please stay safe and well out there, everyone. And thank you for tuning in.